It is Saturday morning in the quiet San Jose Mountains where we continue our search for wood steel. This is our third attempt at creating a high-carbon ingot that is forgeable and exhibits dendritic patterns. These patterns result from carbides segregating around certain impurities in the charge. For this experiment, we are preparing two clay graphite crucibles that will be charged with wrought iron, charcoal powder, O1 tool steel, and glass. As you may notice, we use only the highest quality ingredients. We are aiming for 1.4% carbon for the first ingot and 1.6% carbon for the second ingot. We do not know how much carbon will be absorbed from the crucibles themselves. The reason for adding O1 tool steel into the mix is to provide a source of vanadium and chromium. It is around these impurities that the carbides will segregate and create visible patterns on the surface of the steel. The glass acts as a flux and will completely cover the surface of the ingot, protecting it from oxygen. We also add a little bit of borax, which may help with cleaning the steel. As our source of carbon is from charcoal powder, we need to completely seal the crucible so that the charcoal does not get burned up. In this case, we use satanite at the bottom of an old crucible to provide the seal. In our previous experiments, we had run the furnace inside of the shop. As this resulted in a measurable increase of the sealing temperature, we have set it up to run outside today. To ignite the propane, I place a burning paper at the bottom of the furnace where the propane air mix enters. The noise made by the furnace is quite impressive, but is difficult to convey on the video. For the first run, in which the whole furnace needs to be heated up, it took about 35 minutes to reach melting temperatures above 2800 degrees Fahrenheit. In the meantime, the second crucible has been prepared and is sitting in the sun for the clay to dry. The setup of the furnace is fairly simple. We run at about 4.5 psi of propane, and the nozzle opening in the furnace has a diameter of about 1.5 inches. After we believe the charge to be completely molten, we cool down the furnace a little bit and wait another 30 minutes so that the liquid steel can solidify slowly. Now it is time to remove the first crucible and place it in a bucket of vermiculite where it can slowly cool down further. The air from the furnace is very hot and face protection helps with the operation. In this case, we not only removed the crucible, but also the pedestal it was resting on. We need to rescue that for the next crucible. Later in the evening, the crucible has cooled down enough for us to retrieve the ingot. This is almost like unwrapping a Christmas present, since we do not know what we will find inside. Here, we have removed the refractory mortar and are about to remove the layer of glass on top of the ingot. Some vigorous shaking is going to reveal it. To get an idea how much carbon the ingot might have absorbed, we do a quick spark test in comparison with W1 tool steel, which has a carbon content of about 1%. However, a look at only the top already shows a segregation of carbides forming the dendritic pattern we expect from a Wootz-like ingot. Before starting to forge the ingot, it is time to look at what we got in the second crucible. Looking at the glass on top of the ingot reveals a very smooth surface, indicating that at the time the glass solidified, there were no gaseous reactions happening. While this ingot does not show as clear dendritic patterns as the first ingot, some can still be discerned. Now, it is time to start working the first ingot. The hope is that after some thermal cycling, it will deform without cracking or breaking. For the first few operations, I very lightly employ a hydraulic press. Unfortunately, the ingot is not behaving and big cracks developed, which I am trying to grind out without much success. The subsequent operations just show how difficult it is to work this ingot. The colors in the video do not correspond to the colors in reality. While I'm working with frustration on the first ingot, the second ingot is being thermally cycled many times. To make the best of this failure, I'm going to take samples from the first ingot and get their chemical composition analyzed. Ultimately, all of this is a learning experience that will allow for improvements in the future. However, before finishing this episode, here's a spectacular example of the challenges posed by this ingot. A light edge of it shows some very light patterning, but experimenting with bringing out the pattern first requires workable material. As such, our search for Wootz continues.